The June 16, 2015 meeting of the Planning Board of Cape Elizabeth to order. I'll first go over the agenda. I'd like to say in advance, we have a fairly long agenda this evening. I'm going to ask my colleagues in the board and the presenters and any members of the public who want to be heard to try to be concise in their remarks so that we can get through this fairly long list of stuff. The first item will be the approval of the minutes. We have one item on the consent agenda, which is dealing with minor matters. It has to do with the Mitchell Highlands subdivision amendment, and they're requesting an amendment to correct some mathematical bearing and distances on a plan previously approved. An item of old business is the application by the Inn by the Sea, requesting amendments to a previously approved site plan to replace the 12-unit 500 building with a new 12-unit building. New business, we have Sea Salt Market site plan amendments, requesting amendments to a previously approved plan to remove a tree and to change the signage. We then have a request by the Haffenrether Trust at 1200 Shore Road for a private accessway permit. We then have Cottage Brook Subdivision requesting an amendment of a previously approved Spurwick Woods subdivision to change the design of 19 condominium units. We then have special event facility overlay district zoning amendment and zoning map amendment. I'm sorry, that's a mouthful. Request by the town council to consider an amendment to the zoning ordinance to create a facility, a way to permit special event facilities to be conducted. The last item on the agenda is the Paper Street Public Engagement Plan recommendations. This is part of a Paper Street three-part plan the town council is engaging in to consider the vacating or not of paper streets in the town. And lastly, an opportunity for public comment. First item of business, the approval of minutes, which have been circulated. Is there any comments, questions, or discussions among the members? Being none, I'll ask for a motion to approve.
Move to approve.
Joe, second?
Second.
Jonathan, second. We have an approved motion. Is there any discussion on the approved motion? All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. The next item of business, is the Mitchell Highlands, subdivision amendment. The we'll have a brief presentation with comments on a consent agenda.
On the consent agenda, the applicant is here to answer questions, but you typically don't have to get a presentation. He's just available in case you have questions.
Okay, okay. Very good. You know, we have a memorandum and some materials submitted by Mr. Mitchell on behalf of the applicant. John, would you like to make any brief remarks on this?
Just that this is a request to make a correction in the meets and bounds of the Hills lot. It was brought to our attention just recently that there wasn't a full closure in the lot, so we're here to amend that subdivision and to make it right and re-record the subdivision plan.
There's been no alteration in the dimensions of the parcel?
No alteration. In fact, all the lines are correct. It's right. Just the math.
Right.
Yep.
Is there any questions or comments by the board?
Can I make a motion then?
Certainly.
Be ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Eric Hills for an amendment to the Mitchell Highlands subdivision to correct mathematical bearings and distance on a plan previously signed by the Planning Board and recorded April 17, 2014, for a lot located at 27 Kildare Road be approved.
Second.
We have a second by Carol Ann. The motion is made and seconded. Is there any discussion on the motion? All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. We will next hear from the Inn by the Sea, the requesting a site plan review for the replacement of the 12-unit 500 building with a new 12-unit building at 40 Bowery Beach Road. The application was deemed complete at the May 19th meeting, and the public hearing on the application on its merits was scheduled for this evening. The planner will provide a summary of the project within the context of town regulations. Representatives of the applicant will summarize changes made to the plan since the last meeting. We will then give the public an opportunity to be heard. Following that, the board will discuss and then consider approving or disapproving the application. Maureen, would you like to?
Sure. The Inn by the Sea is in the Business B district where this use is a permitted use. The 500 building is an existing 12-unit building, and it's proposed to be replaced with a new 12-unit building. So a lot of the typical impacts from site plan review aren't really applicable because it's the same use being replaced. Recommendations from staff are limited to asking for the plans to be stamped by professionals, which is typically what happens at the very end of a review process, and also requiring a performance guarantee for the proposed improvements.
Yeah, I should add also that we have done a site, the planning board has had a site walk on the premises in the context of this application. Yes, sir.
Eric Duby from Casco Bay Engineering, representing the project tonight. Basically, from our site walk, one of the issues that we talked about was adding a note to the landscape plan. I think that was really the only issue that we had. We provided that note. And at this point, we're issuing stamp plans. Take care of that. I know that'll be on basically an item that we're going to have to deal with. Beyond that, we really haven't made any changes. It's a 12-unit, as we discussed. Sewer and water are going to remain the same. We're replacing a 12-unit with a 12-unit. Parking, we're decreasing a little bit, but still above what we need for requirements. And our volume and our lot coverage are both within the requirements, and that's been checked by Ben and Maureen. So at this point, I'll entertain any questions and go through what we need to.
Any questions by members of the board?
I didn't really have any questions. This is very complete. This is a great project. I would say we did do the site walk, and I was actually quite impressed to hear about the landscaping and the efforts that the Inn by the Sea are making to bring back the native habitat. And this is quite an extensive plant species list that you have. I mean, we have like, you know, 51 of this, 59 of those, 85 of these. I mean, it's very extensive.
It is.
And I did find out when you were showing, giving us the site walk, that you actually have a rabbitat where you're bringing the bunnies back to the town for your efforts. And I would just want to applaud you for putting in the native plants that create the sustainable landscape and support the wildlife habitat, similar to the work. And I would be remiss if I didn't know John Mitchell's efforts similarly at Fort William. So I just wanted to point that out.
Great, thank you.
Eric, you recall toward the end of the site walk, there was a tree that stood between the 500 building closest to the ocean and the 600 building. And when you talked about the way the buildings would shift slightly over, the future of that tree was in doubt. Am I looking at the right spot on your landscape plan that this is a substitute for that tree?
That's correct. We're going to try to replant the existing, and that's why we had the note, and we had extensive conversation about the note, trying to retain the trees and the and landscaping that was part of the 600 building, and also anything around the existing 500 building.
The tree that you show right here, that is either the tree or its replacement, is that correct?
That's correct.
Is that the replacement, or is that the same tree?
I believe that's the replaceable.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Further questions before we proceed to have a motion? Thank you. Off to a fast start here. The next step in this process will be an opportunity for the public to be heard on this application. Are there any members of the public who would like to be heard? There being none, we'll close the public hearing portion and proceed. Any further discussion? If none, I'd entertain a motion. Jonathan?
Findings of facts, or motion for the board to consider findings of fact. The In by the Sea LLC is requesting site plan review for the replacement of the 12-unit 500 building with a new 12-unit building located at 40 Bowery Beach Road, which requires review under Section 19-9 site plan regulations. The town engineer is recommending that the plan set be updated with professional seals and lighting information transferred to the plans. The application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the In by the Sea LLC for site plan review for the replacement of the 12-unit 500 building with a new 12-unit building located at 40 Bowery Beach Road be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that the plans be revised and submitted to the town planner to add professional seals and to transfer lighting information to the plan set. Two, that there be no issuance of a building permit nor alteration of the site until a performance guarantee has been provided to the town in a form acceptable to the town attorney, an amount acceptable to the town engineer, and all acceptable to the town manager.
Is there a second?
Second.
Joe? We have a motion made and seconded. Is there any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Thank you very much.
The next item on the agenda begins the list of new business. This is the Sea Salt Market Site Plan Amendment, requesting the previously approved site plan be amended to permit removal of tree and a change in signage. The procedure will be, as usual, the applicant's representative will summarize the changes requested. The board should consider then whether or not the application is complete, and the public will be given a chance to speak on that subject. excuse me. If it is determined the application is complete, we will then proceed to consider the application on its merits.
John? Okay, thank you. John Mitchell. The original site plan application for Sea Salt included approving the removal of a 36-inch oak tree that's located right in front of the building, approximately 14 or 15 feet away from the building. It's a very large oak tree that overhangs a portion of Route 77 and is right there, right in front of the building. It was decided during construction, primarily for cost-saving purposes, to preserve that tree. And so we came back to the board, we amended the site plan to preserve the tree. Since then, and since the opening of the market, Mike and Stephanie Concannon, you know, they experienced the inside space and the operation, as well as getting a lot of feedback from the public about removing that tree. The comments that have been provided, and this is their feeling also, that the tree detracts visually from the front of the front facade, as well as it constricts the feeling of openness at the main entrance. So we're before you tonight to request to remove that tree and replace it with a smaller flowering deciduous tree that's more in scale with the building. That would be placed at the southeast corner of the building, as well as with some deciduous shrubs and perennials. We prepared an exhibit A in your packet that shows a photo simulation, or shows the top photo is the existing condition with the existing oak tree, and then the bottom photograph, we've removed that tree and replaced it with the proposed plantings that I mentioned. That's the first item. The second amendment that we're requesting has to do with signage. There are three changes that we're proposing for the signs. The first has to do with a freestanding sign, which is located right here at the corner of the entrance. That is, as it exists today, that's a 2-foot by 3-foot oval sign. The feeling is that they would like to, Mike and Cannon would like to increase that slightly to a 3-foot by 4.5-foot oval sign. The same design, the same layout, the same height, just replace it with a larger sign. And Exhibit B illustrates the that sign, the oval sign. The second change to the signage would be the wall sign. This would be the existing oval sign that we're proposing to replace would be placed on the north side of the dumpster enclosure facing the high school entrance drive. And then Exhibit C shows a graphic of that, again, before and after. And then the third sign would be a rectangular sign that measures 12 feet long by 18 inches wide that would be placed on the back side, the rear side of the building, just below the second story windows. And Exhibit D shows the before and after. So the total signage would equal 73.9 square feet, and the maximum allowed in this zone is 75 square feet. So we're under that. So those are the two amendments: the tree removal and the changes in the signage.
Thank you. Before we open to the board to ask questions and whatnot, want to give the public a chance to be heard on this application on the issue of completeness. Any members of the public wish to be heard? Being none, we'll close that public portion and open to the board to ask any questions we're still on the completeness issue, Jonathan?
Yes, with regards to the signage, I believe you were at the workshop, but there was an issue with about changing the sign that was on the building facing Route 77, is that no longer on the table? Is that not a proposal?
That's not a proposal.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's changed since the workshop?
What was the, I'm sorry, what was the comment?
I thought there was a talk of increasing the sign that was on the building, making that bigger.
The sign right over the front entry talked about making it bigger.
Yeah, that's not going to happen.
All right, so the increase in the signage is actually that there's going to be a new sign on the back of the building?
Correct.
That's basically the same size as the one that's on the...
It's smaller.
Smaller.
Smaller, yeah.
Thank you.
Same design, layout, rectangular, but slightly less in dimensions.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions on the issue of completeness? Being none, I'll entertain a motion on the issue of completeness. Victoria?
I'd like to make a motion. Motion for the board to consider on completeness. Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of KMC Properties LLC for amendments to the previously approved site plan located at 349 Ocean House Road to remove a tree and change signage be deemed complete.
Second.
Second by Joe. We have a motion made and seconded. Is there any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Excuse me. We will turn next to the application on its merits. John, I don't know if you have anything further to add to it.
Well, Mike just came in. Mike Buchanan. Mike, do you have anything to add on the preview?
Sure. I guess just on the tree removal, it was supposedly in our original plan, and then during the construction, something that didn't get taken down, we thought we'd try to live with it. But being open 8 months now, we've had so many people come in and say they've driven by, they've missed the building, and they haven't seen our signage, and the tree basically blocks kind of the view you see of our sign. So I think in hindsight, it was a mistake for us not to take it down at that time, just for being a small business. And it was basically people coming from out of town that aren't familiar with Cape that kept saying, we kept missing your building and not seeing it. So by removing the tree, that would be very helpful to us. So thank you.
Before the board goes further into this, I want to offer the public a chance to be heard on the merits of the application. Any members of the public wish to be heard? Being none, pardon me. The board have any questions for the applicant or discussion? Caroline.
I just want to comment on the Exhibit A and how astounding it is when that tree comes down, how it opens that up, and it just really makes the building stand out. Surprising what that one thing can do. I do have a question on the planting. Does this exhibit represent the actual plants that will be going in front of the building, or
or
is it just something to fill in the space?
The tree is accurate. That's in the accurate location. Of course, it won't look like that in year one. It will take, you know, 3 or 4 years to get that spread. The perennials in the foreground are accurate. What's not accurate are we added five dwarf spirea.
Okay.
In front of the perennials. Those are not shown, but...
those have a little height to them?
They do, yeah. They will grow 2.5 to 3 feet high.
I like the idea of when one tree goes down and you replace it with another one. My only question, though, is with the new planting of that tree, is that going to interfere with the line of sight to the sign that is out front?
No, it's not. I looked at that.
Okay.
And it won't.
All right.
It won't. I mean, it may require, you know, annual pruning of the tree to maintain that sightline, but...
Okay, I just want to make sure that was something else.
Yep.
Yeah, I guess adding what Carol Ann said, I looked several times now at that tree, and it's pretty beat up, it's had a bunch of surgeries, and I can see the problem, and I think your solution is really quite attractive, my own impression. Jonathan?
Just one other question, I wasn't on the board when this originally went through, but was there any sort of trade-off with regards to, I know you said that the reason that the tree was kept originally, it was supposed to be gone, then it was going to be kept because of cost, but was there any sort of trade-off saying, we're going to keep this tree, therefore, you're going to do something else?
It was not kept because of cost, it was more when they did the, I think they forgot to exit, so for them to come back, the tree company to come back a second time, so there was place to take it down the first time, but then to come back again, it would be additional, so we're like, we thought it would give us some shade and stuff, and then we realized it was kind of a nuisance to, you know, the sightline of the building.
Okay, and if you can recall, was there any public comment about wanting to keep that tree or anything like that?
No. No.
Thanks.
Yep.
Any other questions, comments for the applicant? Being none, entertain a motion on the application on its merits. Joe?
Motions for the board to consider. Motion for approval. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of KMC Properties LLC for amendments to the previously approved site plan located at 349 Ocean House Road to remove a tree and change signage be approved.
Second.
Second by Carol Ann. We have a motion made and seconded. Is there any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? None. It carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Okay, we will next hear, from the Rudolph F. Heffenreffer, the Fourth Trust, requesting a private access way permit to construct a driveway to a lot to be located at 1200 Shore Road.
Mr. Curry?
Yes, ma'am.
It appears that the planning board has been exceptionally efficient and that the representative for the Shore Road item is not here, but the representative for the Cottage Brook subdivision amendment is here.
That being the case, let's jump ahead.
I hope so.
Yeah, I guess I was raising a false alarm on the amount of time it takes.
No, that was good. That was good.
I took you seriously.
Okay, let me give me half a second here. Cottage Brook LLC is requesting amendments to a previously approved subdivision known as Furwick Woods, now known as Cottage Brook, to change the footprints of the condominium units located off Astor Lane. This will be reviewed under Section 16.2.5 amendments to previously approved subdivisions. The planner will provide a summary of the project in the context of town regulations. The applicant will summarize the proposed changes, will then consider the issue of completeness, and the public will have a chance to be heard on that subject. We may then, if it is found to be complete, go on to consider the application on its merits. Again, the public will have a chance to be heard if they wish. And as soon as the planner gets back to her chair, she will give us a summary of the project. Oops.
Oh, just scoot it out of
here. Well, there you go.
She's also the lighting director.
Oh, yes. Okay. So Cottage Brook LLC was originally approved several years ago as the Spurwink Woods part single-family lot subdivision, part condominium project.
The portion of the project that is single-family homes, is all the road stuff has basically been complete. I believe most of the lots have been sold, and the prior owner has sold the condominium portion of the project to a new owner, now known as Cottage Brook LLC. I believe the principal is Joel Fitzpatrick. So the proposal tonight is to amend the original approval to change the footprint of the units, because he's switching out one set for another. And because it's a new property owner, honestly, this is something the board typically does anyway. You look at financial and technical capability as well. So unless there are any questions.
Any questions for Maureen by the board? Okay, the applicant, if you could identify yourself, sir.
Certainly. Good evening, and thank you for hearing us tonight. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with the firm of Sebago Technics, here tonight on behalf of Cottage Brook LLC. And apparently I even beat my client here tonight. So Joel is usually here, and so I'm sure he'll be right along. Joel Fitzpatrick, who you folks may know from Eastman Meadows and from the workshop meeting we were at recently, has acquired the last phase of the Spurwink Woods project, which is 19 duplex and one, in total it's 19 units, one with one singleplex unit. Joel has had a successful project with the Eastman Meadows project, and would like to bring those same unit types to this project. We are proposing to keep the same road alignment, same utilities. Essentially, if you look at this plan and the original subdivision plan, it's very hard to tell there's really been any change. And I have a graphic here in a few minutes to show you the original units dimensions overlaid on the proposed units. So our amendment is to amend the plan for some minor changes in the floor plans of the buildings, the roadway, the utilities, the stormwater, everything else will remain the same. We did find out this week that we held the name on their plan that was called South Street, and that is incorrect because the road is Astor Lane. So we will end up having a different name for each one of these spur roads, which is written up in the memorandum, but that's just a naming item. So let's see, hopefully I'll do this right, Maureen. I think I showed these pictures at the last meeting. These are the types of units that are built over at Eastman Meadows. This picture was taken this spring, actually. I bet you there's probably grass out there now. But if you had a chance to stop by, you could see the units. The markets that Joel has approached or has tried to bring in have been basically the empty nesters. Mostly the 55 and older group, and I had a kind of a presentation for the board at the last meeting on the need for that type of housing. Joel's approach has been single-story living designed around the aging population, handicap accessibility. So all of his units are single-story units, and it's been very, very successful for him. And this is a picture of one unit. And then this is another unit. These would look very, very similar. In fact, the units will be identical to what you see here. Here's another picture of the interior layout. Garage, living space, kitchen with breakfast nook, covered porch, a bedroom, a bath, master bedroom, bathroom, and then his units have options for a den, a sunroom, and I can't even read that myself. I think it's a porch off the back of the building. And those options, what he's finding is most people are looking to obtain those options. And these buildings do have full basements in them. That's been a real strong selling point. It's been an item that people like to have a basement. Some of the basements even get finished over time. And then this next graphic is a blow-up of the units that shows you the overlay, and I'll take a minute to explain it. So the double cross hatch area you see here are the original building area that will not be built. So you can see that this was originally building that won't be built. And there are some fringe areas, one here, one over here, and these are a matter of a couple of feet. There's another area here around the front and then over here. But what Joel will be building is these crosshatched areas here, which weren't originally building space. In this location over here, and here. The original building square footage footprint was about 5,314 square feet. What Joel is proposing to build is about 5,000 square feet, slightly smaller, but all on one level, which has worked very well. So what we're here for tonight is, I believe, is for a completeness review, and if appropriate with the board, we would be seeking an amended subdivision approval. Hopefully I got that right, Maureen. With that, I'm more than happy to try to answer questions the board have. I can go back through slides that you would like to see. Just let me know. Thank you.
Thank you. We will open the meeting now to any members of the public that would like to be heard on the issue of completeness of this application. There being none, we'll close the public portion. The board have discussion, questions for the applicant on the issue of completeness. Carolyn?
I just want to thank you. You've clarified any question I had from the workshop, and you've done a nice job.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Questions? And this, if you could refresh my memory, there was either no grading changes or very minimal grading changes. Is that correct from the previous plan?
Yeah, actually, we have reduced the amount of grading on this site. If you remember the original plan, there was a lot of cut and fill on this property. And through the use of some daylight basements, we were actually able to reduce some of that grading. And I think that was commented on by Steve Bradstreet in his review letter. And we wanted to try to reduce some of that grading. There were some very steep slopes on the original plan. We've been able to reduce that significantly. We hope it's a better project.
Thank you, John.
And also one thing to just clear up also. The original plan called for a two-story
That's correct.
Condominium, and this is going to be a single-story condominium.
That's correct.
Okay, thanks.
Being no further questions, entertain a motion on the issue of completeness. John?
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cottage Brook LLC for amendments to the previously approved subdivision approved as Spurring Woods, now known as Cottage Brook, to change the footprints of the condominium units located off Astor Lane be deemed complete.
Second.
We have motion made and seconded. Any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? The motion carries unanimously. We will proceed next to consider approval of the application on its merits. I don't know if you have anything further to add in your presentation.
No, okay. But I'm here to answer questions if you have
Thank
any.
You.
Thank you.
Any members of the public wish to be heard on the application on its merits? There being none, we'll close the public portion. Members of the board, Victoria.
I did have just a couple of, I was looking at the plat and just pointing a few things out. I know you'll be changing the names of these roads. How about down in your notes? Have you also, will you be capturing that when it mentions these roads, such as note number 18, you do want to change the notes that talk about Dogwood and Astor Lane in 18, and in 19 it mentions South Street. I just want to point out that those, of course, also need to be changed.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I also want to point out, would it be okay that if you were to add on, I think it was note number 16, I'm now trying to find it, add that, oh no, it's number 17. Okay, on the plan for the date is September 29, 2000. Nope, now I got to figure out which one it is. I'm trying to add the book and the page to the December 13, 2000 change. And I have to find now which note it was. Sorry about that. Anyone jumping ahead and see it for me?
I have a plan dated 6-3 of 15, note 17. Was it note 17 or?
Maybe it's 17. I'll get back to that one. That's my fault. I forget
which one.
How about on note number 15?
Okay.
If you don't know the project, it can be confusing because it was known as Spurwink Woods. I'm not sure if it's appropriate or just a suggestion that on there it was known as Spurwink Woods, now known as Cottage Brook Subdivision. I'm not sure if that's needed, necessary, or...
Yeah, I'm looking at Maureen.
I think there's a danger in that because the entire approval referred to Spurwink Woods. And if we understand that it's called Cottage Brook now because it was the choice of the property owner, the approval still harks back to Spurwink Woods. And if we change one note, we're going to have to go through everything.
Okay.
And I'd be nervous about that.
All right, I wouldn't want that.
I did try to add note 18 to, you know, specifically indicate what the change was on this plan, so if somebody's researching it in the registry, they would know that this plan only amends that Cottage Woods portion.
Okay. Do these plans need a signing block? I forget if this is something that I'm not sure if I found the signing block on sheet one. Was that signing block on a different sheet, or did I overlook it on
sheet? No, we will have a signature block when the Mylar comes back to the board. I have to change the, I saw the signature block wasn't, and I have to address the road names, and then we'll have the signature block when it comes back to the board. The hope, I think, was is that we would go through the amended process tonight. We'd work with the fire chief and the assessor on appropriate road names, because I have to be careful because of E911 stuff. And then there would be a Mylar coming back to the board for signature at the next meeting, I think.
Okay, those are the only things that I noticed on the plan. Thank you. Thank you.
Further comments, questions from the board? We will then entertain a motion on the merits.
I'll do this one.
Well,
they've done all the others. I'll do
this. Actually, can I ask one further question? I see that we have been joined by Mr.
Oh, we made it.
I just noticed him myself, so can I ask
absolutely.
One question? I heard the presentation at the workshop, which is not recorded, and you'd have to be there to have heard that presentation on why you would actually want to take over this and why you would want to build these houses. Because I recently read something that says multiplex housing such as this is unwelcome, undesired, and unneeded. Do you have any comments to that you would like to put on the public record in regards to why you would actually take over this project if there's seems to be this impression out there, would you say?
Where did you read
that? It's out there, not about this project, but about multiplex in general.
Maybe I can help you.
But I was just wondering, I mean, here you are, you're somebody that is doing what there's a general impression is unwelcome, undesired, unneeded, and I was just wondering if you had a quick comment, because we heard it in the workshop, but it wasn't on the public record.
Well, I kind of disagree with that. It's needed and it's welcomed. And it's the opposite of all that. I found that with the Eastman Meadows. I actually had to slow the sales down at Eastman Meadows a little bit to keep my inventory, you know, at a steady pace. And it depends on where you are. You know, the town of Cape Elizabeth, I think there's still a need and a desire for this type of housing. A lot of my customers now are coming are retired parents or retiring parents or of people of younger families who live here in Cape Elizabeth. So the younger families are coming for the school system because it's a nice place to live. And I've seen that their parents from around the country want to follow their grandkids. So we're getting that type of clientele.
Okay, I appreciate your time and allowing me to ask that question. Thank you very much.
You ready?
Thank you. Carolyn.
Motion for approval, findings of fact. Cottage Brook LLC is requesting amendments to the previously approved subdivision approved as Spurwink Woods, now known as Cottage Brook, to change the footprint of the condominium units located off Astor Lane, which requires review under Section 16-2-5, amendments to a previously approved subdivision. Two, road name changes authorized under the addressing ordinance should be reflected in the updated plan. Three, the applicant has substantially addressed the standards of the subdivision ordinance, Section 16-3-1. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Cottage Brook LLC for amendments to the previously approved subdivision approved as Spurwink Woods, now known as Cottage Brook, to change the footprint of the condominium units located off Astor Lane be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that the plans be revised to update the name of Astor Lane. Further, that the condominium private roads located north and south of Astor Lane each be individually renamed in accordance with the addressing ordinance. The plan should then be updated with the new road names. That the plans be revised and submitted to the town planner for review and approval prior to recording the subdivision plat. That there be no issuance of a building permit nor alteration of the site until a performance guarantee has been submitted in a form acceptable to the town attorney, an amount acceptable to the acting town engineer, and all acceptable to the town manager.
You have a second? Second. Joe. Excuse me, do we have a motion made and seconded? Is there any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? The motion carries unanimously.
Thank you for your time.
Okay, we will now return to the previous item on the agenda, the application by the Rudolph F. Affenreffer Fourth Trust for a private accessway permit at 1200 Shore Road. The process will be as follows. The town planner will summarize the applicable town regulations. The applicant's representative will introduce the project. We will then make a determination on the issue of completeness, at which time the public will have a chance to be heard if they wish. If the application is found to be complete, the board may continue to consider this on the merits. We will also decide whether or not a site walk or a public hearing should be scheduled.
I have not advertised this for a public hearing tonight.
Oh, this notice just for the
just notified for completeness.
Okay, I stand corrected. So the we will be considering only completeness tonight and not the application on the merits. Maureen, would you summarize the background of this?
Sure. So the project is located in the Residence A district, and the applicant came to the planning board last year with a workshop presentation and then submitted a formal application, which was held up for lack of completeness because of right title and interest issues. So I want to thank the applicant for working with the town to try to resolve those issues. The main issue is that the lot in question that is the subject of the private accessway permit is more than large enough to be a conforming lot in the RA district. It doesn't have any frontage on a town road, but it does have rights to create a driveway that will connect to Shore Road, so the applicant is before you for a private accessway permit for that driveway. However, the lot that you are reviewing was on a plan that included a second lot that was undersized the moment it was created. and it also has relationships to that lot by deed, and that's the beach lot. It's a 40,000 square foot lot. It was created in 1997 when the minimum lot size was 80,000 square feet. And that lot, because of its relationship to this lot, there's been a ton of public confusion about the opportunity to build on the beach lot, and that was the right title and interest issue that town staff have raised. The applicant has proposed an agreement, which the town attorney and the code enforcement officer have accepted, that clarify the status of the beach lot. That agreement hasn't been signed yet, and staff is recommending that that agreement be signed. Also, the original plan that created the beach lot shows a building envelope, and staff is requesting that that whole building envelope be removed because that's inconsistent with the a written agreement that the town and the applicant have come to an agreement on. So you are just reviewing the private accessway permit, but because these other issues have been referenced in my memo, I wanted to give you the background.
Thank you. Any questions for Maureen before we proceed? We'll now hear from the applicant's representative summarizing the project.
Good evening, board members. Stephen Moore, on behalf of the Rudolph F. Happenrepper IV Trust. Sorry, I was a little late. Maureen's done a pretty good job giving you a summary. I'm going to take you through this in a little more detailed fashion than we did in the workshop because it's been a little while. This first board that's up shows the context of the area of the easement and the lot with respect to the Atlantic Ocean, which would be towards my side, and town center, which is on the extreme left of this, and then Shore Road at the top. And it really sits in the middle of a parcel that was deeded from Strout to Happenrepper, and then Happenrepper to the Land Trust. The plan that Maureen mentioned that actually created these parcels is this plan here, which is from 1997. So Strout deeded to Happenrepper, Happenrepper purchased. Happenrepper then kept the lot that's in green, the dark green lot, which is the 2.34 acre lot that we're proposing to access via the striped green area, which is the easement for utilities and access granted as part of the original conveyance to the land trust. And at the time, that little hatched 40,000 square foot area was created and conveyed to Happenrepper because at the time Happenrepper owned all of that. So in 97 that little hatched area was conveyed out to Happenrepper. The yellow was all conveyed to the land trust. So the land trust owns the fee interest in everything, including the easement area, but the easement is that band of land that was reserved by Happenrepper for utilities and access from Shore Road. When the Happenreppers subsequently sold the parcel to the south, it in effect abandoned that little 1 acre piece, the beach lot, and that's when the problem started. But as Maureen has said, we've been able to work with our attorney, with the town attorney, and with the code officer to create a restrictive covenant that makes it clear that unless either the ordinance changes or that lot's conveyed to somebody else, it's unbuildable. The only thing that can happen on there is a set of steps to get down to the shore. Period. Because this plan's been recorded and is referenced as an exhibit, we came to the realization about a month ago that we've got to correct this plan and record it with the appropriate notations about that lot being subject to those restrictions. So we're thinking that we'll go through the process. We have executed, as you saw in the submission, Peter has signed, Rudolph Happenrepper has signed for the trust that restrictive covenant. As we work our way through this with the board, we'd hope that the town would sign it, then we'll record that, get the book and page, then put the book and page on this and record this. And then we'll record the private way plan, so there's a train and a chain and a sequence that all makes sense to somebody doing that. So this plan has already been corrected, the building window's been removed, and we've taken those notes off, and you'll see that in this next submission, that we've cleaned that up, and we have the notes on that as well. So in 97, the lot was created, and that access easement was identified as part of the agreement with the land trust. What's interesting about this parcel is that we have that 2.34 acre basic rectangle square, and then that long access way out. We went in and inventoried all the trees on that because they're really magnificent red oaks, mostly red oaks, a little bit of red maple. And the interest of the Hathenreffers was to put a driveway through there that didn't end up taking down all the oak trees that we think sort of sets the character of the place. We went through that inventory, we picked up all the trees, we identified the wetland edge, which shows up there as that aqua blue area down at the middle part of the plan. And then went through the site, identified the septic area. You have that information from Albert Frick Associates and then some follow-up from the code officer. Looked at the ledge, looked at the trees, and we put the setbacks on there. So you can see we've got just a little under 2 acres of area that we can really tinker with to site that house. And it works, and that's an existing clearing. You can see the tree canopy crowding in on that. We looked at Shore Road. We've got in excess of 400 feet site distance to the left, looking back towards town center, and 275 towards the curve. So we tinkered to get that driveway in where we wanted it, and then came up with this driveway plan that was really guided by three important things. The first one was, don't fill the wetland. Not that anything in the original documents with the land trust said we couldn't fill a wetland, but filling the wetland would seem to contradict the essential nature of building on this parcel. So don't fill the wetland, which meant we had to keep the drive to the western side of the right-of-way of the easement area as it passes through there. So that was one sort of fixed point. The other one was, let's absolutely minimize the tree removal, because it really is a fabulous stand, 100, 125-year-old trees through there. And within that, within sort of the available area to set that driveway from a grade and alignment and wetland perspective, there's something in the order of 75 or 77 of these big mature trees that we identified. So we carefully worked that driveway alignment that you see in gray on this plan. And I think we're removing only 8 or 9 of them, of the trees of that total amount. And that's taking a relatively conservative cut at the grade and fill. So we're pretty happy with that in terms of tree preservation, canopy preservation, and character in terms of that drive alignment. The last criteria was we really wanted to hug that terrain. We wanted that driveway to feel like a drive that would have been built back in the late 19th or early 20th century. So we've really minimized cut and fill in shaping that driveway through that terrain. The only departure from that is where we come up to Shore Road because we have to meet the town standards for a 3% grade and a certain flat and level area before you reach that road. So we've got about 3.5 feet of fill right where we meet the Shore Road shoulder, but the rest of it, we're really down within about 2 feet of grade, just really gently following that, which you can see in the cross section below. So we were happy that we had met all those standards. It's 14 feet wide, it has 1 foot shoulders, it has that turnaround at the end, and then it really just only serves and will always only serve this one lot. We've got no other ability to expand, develop, and go beyond that one lot. So we felt good that we'd met those standards and had those pieces in hand. So in terms of this layout, what we're doing is We built that in. It's a gravel road. The first piece is paved. We have an underground communications and cable conduit that's going to come down one shoulder. In that cross-section on our plans, you can see one conduit that's a spare that's running out. We do intend to put one street light, a residential street light, right out at the intersection so we can illuminate a name and a post or something. But there's no intention to run any kind of lighting down that driveway because, again, the issue for us is character enhancement, and at night, if you're driving in and out, you'll have your headlights on. If you don't, you can walk it in the dark. So there's no intention to put any kind of other light source running up and down that driveway. We looked pretty carefully at the issue of well versus public water. And what we found was, although the public water is more expensive, the major issue for us was the disruption that it would cause to get the water line down that access way, because the water line has limited abilities to make those little bends and curves that show on here. And we ended up, when we laid the water line out, because of ledge and because of this alignment, we ended up cutting a lot more trees and having a much bigger footprint if we ran the water line in there. So our decision was just drill the well, because we knew from the septic work that Albert had done, we had great opportunities for well off on that other shoulder. So we are at the house location, we're about 710 or 740 feet away from the road, and it's a long side connection for the water, so we'd have to cross shore and then come in. So our decision was drill the well, don't put the water line in, deal with that disruption. In terms of some of the comments that have come back, I've talked a little bit about the lot and what we're going to do, the beach lot, to get that cleaned up so it is not buildable and change the plan. We've reviewed the engineer's comments, and there are 19. They seem like a lot, but they're very much housekeeping items for us, labeling this, adding that, putting dimensions on. So there's nothing at all from the Sebago Technics engineering review that we saw as any issue whatsoever addressing in the affirmative, clean that up and get that information on the plans. So there's no real concern on our part about any of those issues. And really, the last one is the driveway maintenance. And again, no issue whatsoever. We've cleaned that up. We've got a draft of that already prepared. So we're ready to move forward and address each of those issues in terms of completeness or follow-up items in an affirmative way. So I think with that, I'll turn it back to the board and let you take care of any questions or concerns or deliberation on this.
Okay, but before the board gets into completeness, I'd like the public to have a chance to be heard on completeness. Just, well, sir, if you could come to the podium, that would be preferable. If you could give your name and address. We have technically a 3-minute time limit. Are you the only speaker? Other folks here like to be heard? So if you want to run over a bit, that's okay.
We're all abutters. So my name is Paul Farrow. I live at 1208 Shore Road, which is the,
our yard's right here, adjacent
to this, and some of the things I wanted to comment on are just basically ask questions and get some information. First of all, I want to commend the applicant for addressing my first concern before I asked it. We wanted to make sure there weren't a lot of driveway lights and street lights in this new thing in our side yard in the conservation area. Thank you. Secondly, also related to lights, we'd like to make sure that the plan is sensitive to the idea of headlights coming and going in our back windows and things like that for where the cars turn and so on. And I don't know what can be done in that area, but it looks like it's probably not going to be a big problem, but we just want to be sensitive to that. And thirdly, I didn't hear any discussion about buffers or anything like that, and it seems like in a lot of these discussions, there's talk about buffers, and keeping the trees where they are seems like an awful good idea. But in addition to that, is there any thought in this kind of presentation about the need for buffers and so on? That's a question, but maybe it's not going to get an answer. And fourthly, I have another question, and that is whether this is in the process now for an application for this thing to be built right away, or to wait until make sure it gets approved, but to wait until the lot is actually sold and somebody wants to build back there. Because we're concerned if a driveway or a road were put in in that conservation land, that it would be a potential problem for kids going back there and in their cars and things like that. We do already find beverage containers and so on in the woods there. So those are my comments for the moment.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we'll now turn to the board to discuss this and ask any questions we might have of Mr. Moore. Jonathan?
One question I have is, I see on your plan you have a turnaround. Would that be considered permissible under the easement as just allowing access and utilities? Why would it have to be on the conservation land to have that turnaround? Why couldn't it be on the actual lot itself?
The turnaround can be on the lot, but also based on the opinion from our attorney, we have the ability to include that in that easement because it's part of our access and egress. The reason we put it right there is it's one of the openings in the tree trunks that allow us to set it there and minimize the grade disruption. It's only sitting in about a foot of fill, just enough for the gravel. So it's really a function of putting it where we had the least amount of damage, fitting it closest to the terrain, and meeting all the radii requirements that the fire department has. And as noted by the town engineer, that driveway as it's drawn there is narrower than what it has to be. We've already widened that out. We understand how it works on the plan. So that's why it's there. And that's not to say it couldn't be inside, but that's the one we were comfortable with in terms of turning radii, egress, limiting damage, all those touchstones that we were using at the outset to have this make some sense.
Carolyn.
Steve, could you speak to any drainage impacts of the business that might have, the water flows and how?
Sure. All of the water that's coming towards this driveway is coming from the west. Some of it's coming from land of Hidden Court. Some of it's coming from the Pharaoh's land. On the drainage plan, we showed you a couple of watersheds. There's a small watershed up on the piece closest to Shore Road, and then there's a larger watershed that extends up onto other land of Haffenreffer. And what we've done is we've done the takeoff of those watersheds and then sized our culverts following the town standards and then included that. So the two culverts we show on our plan intend to convey that drainage under the drive and across and into this lot, which is where it's going historically. We've just made sure we've kept those channels open and kept that flow going. And the differential, as we said in that submission, is pretty minor. It's a pretty small change in terms of the flow, the amount of stormwater.
Steve, could you point out on the map where the Barrows house is located?
I can. Probably the best. They constructed their house right under my finger.
Okay.
And we have that now graphed. We took the aerial photo and carried it over and plopped it on and did some measurements today and looked at a couple elevations. At the closest point, their house is 112 or 114 feet away from the driveway.
From the driveway.
At the turnaround, it's 532 feet away. I had to look at the drawing in my mind. It's 532 feet away from that turnaround, looking back up and through. Elevationally, it looks to us like their house is about 8 to 9 feet higher. So as we exit the house and drive down, it's actually a downward sloping drive as it makes that first big curve. And I can document this for everyone, but as those vehicles are exiting right here, we drop down and that's a gradual pitch up, but we're, at this point, we're approximately 8 feet lower than their house. There's the tree trunks and then there's a stone wall there.
And if I'm reading it correctly, the axis of the headlights is pretty much, it's not aimed at their house at any point other than...
No, the actual, on a headlight, I'm not going to get all technical here. The headlights primarily point down and out. So as long as we're not pitching up at a 5 to 6% grade, we're not going to illuminate their house. But I think this is a case where if you're not willing to have a walk as a group, which I'm happy to do, you should go walk that. The center line of the driveway is staked out. And you can see there's some existing vegetation that's relatively heavy on the hidden court side of the land. Because of the density of the overstory here, because of that canopy, the tree canopy, there's not that much understory here, but there's a little low stone wall. So, I mean, my sense of it today was that we're not going to really have an issue coming up in that area because we're traveling parallel to the short axis of the house. But I think, again, a site walk would help all of you understand that in terms of their house being uphill.
Thank you. Other questions from the board?
It's not around completeness, though, so I don't know if we want to wrap up completeness or you want to just hear questions that get into the merits or...
Well, all we're talking about tonight is completeness, and
okay.
To me it's kind of a fuzzy line sometimes. But the information, at least in my mind, on what the impact of the headlights on the surrounding properties would be was, you know, does knowing more about it was another heading in my mind of completeness.
Mr. Curry? I mean, if the board is comfortable that the application is complete, you can make a motion for completeness. Then you can ask any question you want. You're not restricted.
That's what I was wondering. Do you want me to proceed beyond completeness? I do have questions, but I don't know if the board has questions around.
Well, I'm happy to take them now or after we rule on completeness. I had one more question, which I think is completeness.
I think we should do the completeness and then get into discussion and discuss sidewalk and discuss public hearing. I think we should end completeness. If we don't have any issues with the submission being complete, then let's end it and then let's move on to more questions, whether we're going to do a sidewalk, what kind of things we'd want to see, and then public hearing. That's my suggestion.
Sure.
That's okay, then can I make a motion for completeness?
I'd like to ask one more question, though, which I think is still under
the
completeness. And this is maybe as much for Maureen as for Steve. The topic is the private access way, I understand. And we'd be having the same discussion whether or not the beach lot was in the picture or not. Correct? I mean, the main
review is the private access way permit.
And I'm trying to tie the beach lot into this, and it seems to be a very nice piece of ancillary housekeeping to get the beach lot squared away. But it doesn't have a whole heck of a lot to do with the private access way, unless I'm missing something.
The position that staff have taken is that the private access way permit, you have to demonstrate right title and interest in the property.
Right.
And that the status of the beach lot and the fact that the beach lot is on the same plan that created the 1200 Shore Road lot and that the deed for the 1200 Shore Road lot also includes references to the beach lot sufficiently clouds the 1200 Shore Road lot title that you should be resolving the beach lot issues as part of your right title and interest for the 1200 Shore Road lot.
Okay, no, and I think it's a great idea.
So I would argue that.
But it's a right title and interest issue. It doesn't really go into the heart of the private access criteria.
But the private access way does require you to demonstrate right title and interest. So that was the hook we used.
Right. No, understood. But if the beach lot didn't exist, we'd still have the same application.
Yes, we would.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And that's why we had submitted Peter signed the document. And if the town wants to sign the document, we'll record it.
I never wanted this to sound like this was a lack of commitment by the applicant to resolve this.
As long as the board
just didn't want it to get lost in the whole process.
As long as the board understands that, we understand it, and we're happy to move forward with that.
Okay, if there are no further questions.
I guess I didn't follow some of that. So is that cleared now?
What's that?
Is the right in the title and everything that was just discussed?
What I heard the applicant state was that they were fully willing to sign the declaration of restrictions, and they are fully willing to revise the plan, and they're just going to, for the sake of clarity, wrap it all into the one set of plans that is hopefully the approval of the private access way. And, you know, as long as everybody is of the right, is all rowing in the same direction, and the applicant's willing to do that, we can just make conditions of approval at the end and pull it all together. I don't believe that the applicant's proposal to pull it on one piece is a bad idea. I think it's a great idea.
I did get that, and I wanted to make sure the town was on board. So the town is certainly, I'm not sure who wrote the documents, but there is.
The code enforcement officer and the town attorney worked on those documents with the applicant and the applicant's attorney.
Okay, thank you.
So just not to beat completeness to death,
okay,
that if we rule on completeness tonight, is our expectation that all of that documentation will appear in good order when we consider the application on its merits?
Completeness means things have been submitted. It doesn't mean that it's sufficient. So the applicant has submitted declaration of restrictions, they have submitted plans, and so I believe that you could deem the application complete and still require conditions or whatever you need to on an ultimate approval motion to pull all this stuff forward.
Right. I think you and I said the same thing differently.
Yes.
We said the same thing.
Okay. I don't think you're losing anything if you were willing to move ahead.
Okay. We'll entertain a motion on completeness, Victoria.
Make a motion for the board to consider, then be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Rudolph F. Heffenreffer IV Trust for a private access way permit to construct a driveway to a lot to be located at 1200 Shore Road be deemed complete.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded. Any discussion on that motion? All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. Okay, let's go back and revisit some of this stuff in the context of going forward. How do people feel about the need for a sidewalk?
Yes.
Yeah, and I do have some questions after we discuss the sidewalk in regards to this application.
But everybody's on board to have a sidewalk?
Yes.
Steve, are you planning to come back in the next, are you trying to get this thing done quickly?
We are. So we're hoping to come in on that July 21st for the public hearing. We are.
Do you want to get a sidewalk scheduled now while we're still thinking about it? We had some consensus before Saturday was not good, but early Friday seemed to work for folks. Caroline, is that consistent with your schedule?
It depends on the Friday.
Let me see what we got here.
Well, the 19th is this Friday.
Yeah.
When's the submission deadline?
The submission deadline would be, I believe, July 3rd.
How about Friday the 26th?
July 4th is a Saturday, so yes. And I believe we're closed July 3rd, so probably move up to July 6th. In the interest of disclosure, I'm on vacation next week.
Next week?
Yes.
Okay.
I could do the 19th.
I very rarely do this, but my son graduates from elementary school on Friday. I'm blushing, I'm sorry.
That's okay, these things are important.
He made me promise I'd be there. I apologize.
And the 20th?
Maureen's out the...
I can send someone else. If the 19th is all that works, I'll send... Yeah, that might be fun.
If it's okay with Stephen, I mean...
I'll send...
I wouldn't want you to cancel.
Oh, yeah, no.
No, on your side.
I'd pay for that
Does the 19th work for people?
I cannot be there the 19th. I have to be up at Augusta, but that doesn't mean that.
Well, 1, 2, 3.
I can make the 19th.
4, Henry, and we don't know if Henry or...
No, we don't. I mean, there's also the last week in June. Monday. Is any day of the week is bad, better or worse than Friday?
Probably earlier in the week is better.
How about Monday?
So maybe.
Monday the 29th? Monday the 29th work for folks?
I think.
29th?
How early in the morning would you like to get there? 7:30? 8?
7:30 or 8 works for me.
You can go for 7:30
preferably, but...
I'm 7:30. I'd prefer also. You guys make 7:30?
I'm flexible.
Yeah, 7:30.
Okay, Monday, June 29.
Great.
At 7:30, and...
I'll send out a reminder.
Great, and that just meet out on 77? There's nothing there now that looks like a... There's a path.
There's a little footpath.
Yeah.
You can sort of see it, but we'll have flags up.
Okay.
We have little flags, and we have discrete flags tucked along the road, but we'll put a stake up at the end.
Just a thought, some people may want to park here and take the Shore Road path down to...
That's true.
That's going to be easier, because there's no parking there.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. He's safer.
It's a really nice path.
You just set it down on the path.
Yep.
Okay. Let's go now. We've gotten our... sidewalk, and before we vote on the public hearing, Victoria, you had some things that...
Yeah, I actually wanted to follow up. Carol Ann did bring up something that was in the town engineer's letter in regards to drainage. And the town engineer, I mean, I heard your answer, but the town engineer said it may be beneficial to extend the ditch contours to increase slope and depth. And I didn't quite hear those words used, and this is a little bit beyond my why he would want that. I mean, I'm sure you understand, and I was just wondering if you could address that he said it may be beneficial to extend. What are your thoughts on that?
I believe he's absolutely on point, because essentially what he's saying, I'll put this in pretty simple terms, what we really should do is push those culverts down a little deeper,
mm-hmm.
and then extend the ditch line further to the west, a little bit to the west. Right now, we've set them just 5 or 6 inches into the ground right now in that effort to sort of keep that close to the drain. But it was Steve Harding, really. I think what he was saying there was pretty clear to us, at least, that push that culvert down and get those contours sculpted and cut in a little deeper, so we get a much more positive drainage pattern.
So that's something that you do agree with?
No, I agreed with every...
Okay.
I know there were a lot of them, but there was nothing in there at all. And that ties in very cleanly with his other comment, which was, we have those culverts with less than 2 feet of cover.
Yeah, the cover, you're right.
And so by pushing them down, that gets us the cover, and it allows us to get a really more defined drainage pattern. The tendency would be, we were very tight in the way we kept our footprint small. And what they're saying is, get it a little deeper, make those swales more pronounced, and make sure you've got that water going through there. And we have the elevations to do that, so.
I do recall that most of this is a little bit of housekeeping, and I just wanted to make sure, those are the only two that I found that I wanted to hear that you said, yes, those changes will also, so thank you.
All those changes. Some of them, I don't mean to diminish them, because widening that road out to 24, that has a footprint impact, but from our perspective, everything there was manageable, easy to do, and very straightforward to address.
Okay, I appreciate that. And you did answer the majority of the... we did get that letter from Mr. Farrow, and he did speak, and he did ask about buffering, and I would just say, any buffering standards in our ordinance as it pertains to accessways?
Are there standards in the ordinance? Let me look that up. You have required buffering on rare occasions, but typically it's when there's been no existing vegetation.
Mm-hmm.
So
can I I actually have this open to that.
Super.
Because I was going to actually just put Steve on the spot here for a second and ask him this question directly.
I'm not doing that to you, Steve.
So the ordinance reads, the development is carried out in a manner that minimizes the impact on adjacent properties and is consistent with sound neighborhood development. Now, I think it's pretty hard to say clearly what neighborhood development is consists of in this area. I mean, it's sort of all over the place, but how would you make some sort of defense of what you're proposing being consistent with what I just read there?
As you come down Shore Road, there's a little bit of a density when you first clear the turnoffs and you pass Murray's shop. And the lot size get larger and the houses spread out as you move to the east on Shore Road. And that shows up relatively clearly here. By the time you reach 1208 and the one house before, you're hitting patterns where the houses are 250, 300 feet apart. And they're coming down. And I mean, certainly the way we've sited the house and that lot speaks to keeping that visual density and that type of pattern of development intact. In terms of the driveway, I'm just going to rest on the fact that we spent a lot of time inventorying those trees and figuring out how to make that driveway fit in there to keep that tree canopy intact. And the intent was that from Shore Road, you're not going to feel or see a significant difference other than that driveway dropping in. I'm going to rely on the sidewalk to convey to you the density of understory that's on the adjoining lot. You can see it a little bit. This is land of Hackenreffer. And it's dense. It's a dense understory of honeysuckle, chokeberry, and a little bit of Lindera benzoin, spice bush, that exists along that edge. As you get up closer to the Pharaohs up in here, it's dense here, but it opens up a little bit on that side. But I think you need to see that and experience to understand both the horizontal distance, the vertical distance, and how little an impact that driveway will actually have, both because of spatial separation, but also because of the height differential and the large tree trunks.
And I know you addressed lighting, but what light will be there? Is it just at the front entrance, like maybe at the numbers? Sometimes people...
That's all we're doing. We're just, it's a little bit of a light to let people know where the driveway is, to light up the number, and it'll be dark sky compliant. Whatever that... We see it as something low level, like a little 4 foot, 5 foot high down light on a street number. Just something to clear snow.
That's common along a short road, right?
Right, it is. And it fits that pattern, but it's only up there. And we've discussed this in detail. And to answer the other question, we are not intending to build this driveway unless we have to build the driveway. In other words, there's a certain time frame. Once you grant it, we have a certain time frame in which to execute and build that driveway. The intent is to sell it and let the new buyer build the driveway according to the approvals. Among the many reasons is the one that we don't want to invite people in there. Even a chain across or something, we're still going to get walkers and people in there. So we have no intention to really build that driveway. And there's a couple of people who are quite interested in the lot, which is why I'm pushing that along for that public hearing.
Those are the questions that we did have, and I just wanted to make sure it was very clear, so I thank you. And the last question I had for you is, and this might seem like familiar business, back when we did Hidden Court, I think there was a moment when I said, I went through the plat and I was looking at, and I saw a few things that needed a little updating. I mean, technically now or formally is correct, but I think I saw, it says the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust owns property adjacent to Hackenreffer. I didn't think the land trust property came up to next to the town. And
it does.
It does in the back? Okay. I always thought it was in the front and then Hackenreffer was around.
No, and that's why in that follow-up submission, we've gone through And based on our other experiences with the board, we updated that plan. And I'm blushing again, I reviewed it this afternoon.
Okay.
And I think it'll pass muster. I'm pretty darn sure.
What I have in front of me has been updated.
It absolutely has.
Because I was looking at I was using your hidden court one, and I'm just like, okay, if you pull out your hidden court submission and updated everything except the Tarlings are no longer the other people, they're now the Johnsons. I mean,
right, we did that, and the building window's gone, and those references are gone.
Okay, so I would be looking for the same exact wonderful work that you did.
I was so happy today, thinking exactly those words, how pleased you would be. Seriously, I'm serious.
I know. Okay, so anyways, that was the last that I had.
Should I leave one thing in there? Just, no.
No.
Do we have any other questions from the board?
I just want to thank Victoria for asking that question.
You knew I was going to.
Yes.
I'll entertain a motion to table the application to the July 21st. John?
Be it ordered that the above application be tabled to the regular July 21st, 2015 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
Second by Joe. We have a motion made and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. We'll see you or one of your folks on Monday, June 29 at 07:30.
No, it'll be me on the 29th, right? That's what.
Okay.
Enjoy.
And we will have the driveway center line staked, the turnaround staked, and we can look at all of those. Thank you.
This was in my packet stuck to the back of this.
Okay.
I thought you'd be amused.
No.
The next item on the agenda, excuse me, is the Special Event Facility Overlay District Zoning Ordinance Amendment Proposal and Zoning Map Amendment. We'll ask the town planner to provide a summary of the proposed amendments and some general background on this topic. Comments by the public will then be welcome, and then the board will consider the amendment, and at the close of the discussion, we can either vote to recommend this amendment to the town council or to table the amendment to workshop for further work. Maureen?
Sure. So as you all know, because you've been working on this for, I think this is the fifth meeting, there was a referral from the town council to the planning board to look at some kind of special event facility ordinance amendment that would deal with an ongoing situation where we have basically weddings being hosted in a residential district, and there's some concern that that is not in compliance with the current zoning. So this was referred to the planning board. The area in question is the Wentworth Lodge on the Sprague Corporation. The planning board had concerns with making a special event facility a permitted use throughout the Residence A district. You also had concerns that if someone actually had 15 acres of land and they weren't in a Residence A district, it didn't seem very equitable if they couldn't have the same opportunity for some revenue generation. So this has been converted into an overlay district. And the overlay district approach is that the special event facility is only a permitted use in an overlay district. In an overlay district, you create the structure of a district by amending the zoning ordinance, and then you actually create places on the planet in Cape Elizabeth where an overlay district sits by amending the zoning map. So at the last meeting, you scheduled a public hearing this evening for the text amendments, and subsequently at the June 3rd Planning Board workshop, you also agreed to add to this package a map amendment. And that map amendment would create a special event overlay district in the area of the Wentworth Lodge. It's the Wentworth Lodge, three other properties all owned by the Sprague Corporation, equating to over 15 acres of land. So the proposal tonight creates the district. The district only exists when the council actually places a location on the map where the district can live. If someone wants to operate a special event facility, they would need to come to the planning board for site plan review, and you've created some special performance standards for performance overlay for special event facilities, including things like no amplified music after 10 p.m., no more than 12 events in a calendar year, and no event can last more than 8 hours, including setup and breakdown. I should let you know that I have gotten feedback from the Sprague Corporation. They have some concerns about that because sometimes people will actually set up for an event the day before. So the 8 hours, including setup and breakdown, they're a little concerned that that may not allow the kind of setup they're used to. And then the last piece is probably that this would be unique and that the site plan approval would only last for 3 years. If someone wanted to continue to operate a special event facility, they would have to return for a new site plan approval. And at that point, you would be able to look at things like how the event facility had been operated, if there have been complaints from the neighbors. So for tonight, you have scheduled a public hearing. If you are satisfied with this proposal, you can recommend it to the council. If you feel you want to make more changes and they're minor, you can make those tonight and then still send it to the council. If you feel you need to make major changes, then you should probably table it to a workshop and get into more of the meat of the work. Are there any questions?
I think the Sprague Corporation's point on setup and takedown is probably good. And I think we could probably solve that with a fairly simple drafting tweak.
I agree.
It doesn't seem to be a matter of substance. Before we get into further discussion, I want to give the public a chance to be heard. Oh, yes, ma'am. If you'd come to the podium, please, and identify yourself, and we'd like to hear what you have to say.
I'm Mary Ann Schumann. I live on 11 Eastfield Road. And I'm not sure what the sense of the board is concerning this, but I will just speak as someone who had been the potential mother of a bride who wanted to marry in town. There really isn't any place to marry if you don't have a lovely, lovely, lovely piece of property, which many of us in town do not. There are other facilities are really not available. Yes, Fort Williams or Inn by the Sea, but they're very public venues. The Sprague property offered a very lovely, charming piece of Cape Elizabeth that was also private. And I will also speak to the other portion where 8 hours is really very limited. Vendors need to come in and they may set up tents the night before, depending upon when you're holding your event. The tent, the caterers, et cetera, may not be able to do all of their business in order for this to stay within this 8-hour period. I just want to speak in favor of it. I think it's really important. I think that people who grow up in town should have a place to be able to get married in town. So I hope that you're positive about it. If you're not, I'm not sure what I could say to you that might change your minds. But other than the fact that you probably will know some brides and mothers of the bride who will not be very happy with you if you decide against this. Oh, I should say grooms as well, because boys should be able to get married in the town that they grew up in as well.
Thank you very much. Open this discussion now to the board.
Are you here to speak on that?
Oh.
I was just going to listen.
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't see you there. So no further members of the public. I will then close the public portion of the meeting and open a discussion by the board.
I think Peter's point was a good one. It seems like the renewal every 3 years really takes care of a lot of possible problems with granting a special event status to a particular applicant. and that if, you know, if there are complaints over the 3-year period, you'd have grounds for not granting it the next time around.
I think the 8-hour duration thing, I know from my perspective, I was thinking that the tents and all of the tough stuff like that would be set up and would be there, and it wouldn't be something that would go up and come down every single time. So it could be I was thinking wrong. So that's why I thought the 8-hour duration thing was reasonable. But if that's not the case, and they do need to bring in tents for each event, and it is a put up the tent and break down the tent, 8 hours is not enough time.
I thought the 8 hours was for the event.
The event itself, yeah. And we say including the setup and breakdown.
Yeah, so maybe it's the way we worded it that we could clarify that.
What if you say no event shall exceed 8 hours in duration, so that's the event, excluding setup and breakdown? Is that worded enough that we're getting to the heart of what we mean?
Yeah.
So no event goes over 8, excluding setup, breakdown.
I mean, you may have a tent, you may have some type of a bandstand, you may have caterers bringing in things the day before. I'm agreeing that it's the event itself, the wedding, the reception, the dancing, the whatnot.
I think Victoria's amendment is a good one, because I believe when we discussed this on the numerous times that we did bring this up and looked over the drafts, was that the concern was is that there someone may or would possibly have an event that would last from 9 a.m. until 9 p.m. and we didn't want to see that happening. At the same time, I wanted to give an option for the setup and breakdown. I think having that language of an changing it would be a good,
so just
a good amendment.
Yeah.
And have the excluding as set up right now.
So you're just excluding rather than including, Victoria?
Yes, is that your amendment?
Well, if we
consensus?
Say excluding setup and breakdown. Okay, so in a 24-hour period, you can still only have an 8-hour event. Yeah, so there would be no other reason. I can't think of any other reason in a 24-hour period to want to have more than an 8-hour event. So that's one day. I'm just looking for, like, how did I wordsmith this? I want to make sure, because Elaine's not here to correct me.
Well, what this does do is, you know, you're not going to be able to have two events in one day.
If that's okay with the board.
So if are you saying, say, not including or excluding? What is the actual amendment you're proposing?
I was suggesting we keep all the wording, change the word including the setup and breakdown, which was defined as you can only do it in 8 hours, to excluding the setup and breakdown. So we still have an 8-hour event in a 24-hour period, but we can do the setup and the breakdown not within a certain time frame and not limited by 24 hours.
But is your text changed? Do you change including to read excluding?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay.
And that's by consensus?
By consensus?
Yes.
We'll reopen the public comment. Yeah. Go ahead.
One of the days was you were able to rent the cottage for a week, and there were not going to be a week of events, although some people do, obviously. But there was going to be a rehearsal dinner, and that would have been, say, the wedding was on the Saturday, the rehearsal dinner would have been on the property on Friday. Now, of course, the rehearsal dinner wouldn't have been a wedding, so there wouldn't have been a band and things like that, at least not for our event. But I'm not sure what other people would like to do with these kinds of things. So if you stay within a 24-hour period, then you're not able to have your rehearsal dinner. If you're planning a rehearsal dinner, say for Friday night at 6, you're not able to have your wedding then at 3 the next day. So I'm not sure. And that was one, as I said, that was one of the advantages of the property, where you could have some of the things there. You wouldn't necessarily we weren't planning a huge, huge rehearsal dinner, but our wedding was going to be many out-of-town guests, so who were traveling great distances, and that's why we thought they would find the rehearsal dinner on Friday, then they would know where to come back for the wedding on Saturday. So I hope you can consider that as well. Other families might think the same way.
Well, what if we just, rather than 24-hour period, we set it in a calendar day?
Yes.
You could have your rehearsal on Friday and your wedding on Saturday and your, okay, in a calendar day? So excluding setup and breakdown in a calendar day. Is a consensus change on that?
Yes.
Suitable of everybody?
Yep.
Thank you for your very helpful comments, ma'am.
Oh, you're welcome. I just, you know, having been through some wedding plans, et cetera, you have a different perspective. In the last 2 years before, I was involved
in it. A fresh set of eyes is a good thing. Jonathan?
So, one question I have on that, though. Would that, so the amendment would be that they should not have an event in one calendar day. Now, does that mean that if a proposal, right, that's my point is that if we're limiting this to 12 events per calendar year, in essence, if there's going to be a rehearsal dinner on a Friday, a wedding on a Saturday, would that count as two events?
Yes, I would
it
say
would.
So. Which is fine, because the Sprigs only said six that they needed, so
perfect.
Perfect math.
Yeah, it's a good point. Maybe they have a party on Sunday for the guests. Is that one event or?
And then they have events? then they have a brunch leaving on Sunday for guests.
It is two separate events.
It is two separate events.
And I think we need to move this forward. I think these are great changes. These were wonderful comments, and I think we needed to make these changes. But I think we need to move this forward. And we could parse this in 15 different ways. And
let's run with it.
And let's run with it and see what happens.
Everybody comfortable with that, that approach? Mm-hmm. Alrighty. I think we have a motion.
I do want to say is that I really tried my hardest to really embrace this, because I do support the Wentworth Lodge coming into compliance with the zoning ordinance, but I do want to go on the record that I will not be voting in favor of this recommendation to the town council. And it's because when we heard from the representatives of Sprigg Corporation that the lodge is used about six times a year for weddings, and they'd like to continue holding about six weddings in the future. It was small, it was narrow in purpose, and it definitely had my support. However, I was feeling that the scale, which mean the number of events, number of attendees, duration, hours of amplified music, became larger than the original request that we received. And it's also larger and later than weddings held at the fort or commercial properties such as Inn by the Sea. And then the purpose is no longer just weddings, though we've heard that the focus seems to be weddings. There's nothing in here that says it's just weddings. So also during discussions, I recommended that special events not be allowed to have overnight lodgers, because in essence, I didn't want these facilities to act as hotels, which are certainly not allowed in all the districts, or to be short-term rentals, which have their own guidelines to prevent the large parties and the special events that facilities should be hosting, but not short-term rentals. I just wanted to go on record saying I'm not going to support this when we take our vote, even though I did try to work very hard with the group to come to something, but it's just taken on a
no, and thank you for your thoughts on that. I would just like, on the other side of that coin, though, to say that while the Sprague Corporation's use of the Wentworth Lodge was perhaps the catalyst for this effort, this was not a effort to custom tailor the zoning ordinance to fit the Sprague Corporation's use of the Wentworth Lodge. We were taking the concept and trying to apply it on a more broad but reasonable scale so that people could use their property in that fashion under restraints that we thought were important. So I do take your point, but I do want to say this is not a Sprague-centric zoning ordinance. It's one of general application. Any further discussion?
No.
Jonathan?
And I would just also, and just so the public knows about how the people who weren't able to make it to the workshops of how hard and the board looked at this ordinance to tailor it in a reasonable fashion, and I thank the members of the public who came to the meeting tonight to actually go on record and indicate that it is nice that if the town council adopts this, that there may be, going through all the approval process, a location in the town that somebody can come home and get married and have a wedding. And someone who recently has been or gotten married, it is a nice option to be able to have.
Any further comments or discussion? I'll entertain a motion for the board.
I'll do it.
Charlene?
Motion for the board to consider. The following motion combines the text amendments and the map amendment in one recommendation. Okay. If desired, the planning board may also vote the text amendment and map amendment separately. Do we want to do that, or do we want to altogether?
Let's do it in one vote.
Be it ordered that based on the materials prepared and the edits that will be made, how do I want to phrase that?
You can, where it says the special amendment facility zoning ordinance amendment, comma, as amended.
As amended, okay.
It's a little wordy, but okay. It works.
Be it ordered that based on the materials prepared and the facts presented, the planning board recommends the special event facility overlay district zoning ordinance amendment as amended?
Yep, or as revised.
As revised, and the zoning map amendment to the town council.
Second.
A second. We have a motion made and seconded. Is there any further discussion on that motion?
No.
In favor? Opposed? We have 4 votes in favor, 1 opposed. The motion carries.
I just wanted to point out that attached to your proposal is a draft memorandum. This is intended to be the cover memo that goes with your recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to comment on this, but I wanted to make sure if someone would like to make any changes to this at this time or would like to send in proposed revisions. It's just supposed to capture the effort you put into it and give the council some context when they receive your recommendation. And
would it work if you, within the next year or two, people could get back to you?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Comments from Maureen on it, the memo, otherwise it will go
and
under the name of the board.
And what I do is I give the final memo to the chair, and he approves the text of it.
Okay, we are down to the last agenda item, which, is the Paper Street Public Engagement Plan and Recommendations. The Town Council referred to the Planning Board, the Paper Street Public Engagement Plan and a review of the 2015 Paper Street Report. This has been reviewed by the board. The town planner will introduce the plan. We can discuss the draft recommendation. And at the close of the discussion, we can table the draft recommendation either to a planning board workshop for further review or to the July meeting when a public hearing can be held. Maureen?
Yes. So you're all familiar with the Paper Street Public Engagement Plan adopted by the council. That's a 3-step process. The first step process is a fairly routine review by the Planning Board and by the Conservation Commission of the Paper Street Report. It has an inventory of all the paper streets. We've gotten a little bit of public comment about some paper streets that missed the inventory, so you now have, as far as I know, a complete inventory. And at your workshop, you went through the list and made a recommendation to basically retain all but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of the paper streets. The board can only make actions at regular meetings, and because you always allow the public to speak, it seemed appropriate to table this to a public hearing to get some public comment. But I need to make clear that it was the council's intent in their engagement plan that the majority of the public comment come in parts 2 and 3. the Planning Board and Conservation Commission review was supposed to be more of a pro forma, you know, did this report pick up all the information that should be available for paper streets?
We could entertain public comment, there's no reason.
You can entertain public comment at any meeting.
If any member of the public would like to be heard on the paper street engagement plan at this time. Oh, thank you. Is there any discussion? No, we'll close the public comment on this topic. Is there any discussion by the board members on the current status of our plan, or any discussion on tabling it to the public hearing?
I think we should table it to a public hearing.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion on that point. Caroline?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the meeting materials and the facts presented, the Planning Board tables the paper street public engagement plan draft recommendations to the regular July 21st, 2015 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
And I'll second that.
Okay, we have motion made and seconded. Is there any discussion on that motion? In favor? Opposed? Carries unanimously. And we have our last opportunity for public comment before we adjourn. Okay, there being none, motion to adjourn.
I make a motion we adjourn.
Second?
Second.
Favor? Done. Thank you, everybody.